about it, I'm going to like to introduce you to Dr. Christian.
So it's time for something entirely different now. We're going to have a display of medical detection dogs. Now, I'll hand you over to Ring Comms in a moment, but these incredible dogs use their heightened senses to alert us to medical issues.
And we're very, very excited to be here and to show you what we can do. We're also a little nervous, so be kind to us. As you heard, I'm Dr. Christian Jeston, and I have made various programs with medical detection dogs over the years. And each time I watch these extraordinary four-legged medics, I'm always blown away at just what their wet noses can do. And I'm not a little jealous at how much better they are at their jobs than I am. The use of smell to detect disease is becoming more and more important as we try and find quicker, cheaper, and less invasive ways of being able to diagnose conditions. We're looking for some of the world's biggest killers. In many cases, the dogs do it themselves, or alongside that, we're learning from the dogs. We're learning from the way they smell to be able to develop some artificial intelligence, if you like, an electronic nose to be able to detect conditions. Medical detection dogs have already proved that their dogs can detect diseases like various cancers, Parkinson's disease, malaria, and other infectious diseases. The biodetection dogs working on these diseases can detect minute amounts, trace amounts of odors in samples. If I give you an illustration, it's the equivalent of being able to detect a spoonful of sugar dissolved in two Olympic-sized swimming pools of water. I think you'll agree that is quite incredible. Medical alert assistant dogs are already helping people who live with various conditions that cause them to become ill very rapidly, very quickly, and we're talking in a matter of seconds. They have no idea that they're about to be in danger. Their dogs smell or detect a change in their body odor and alert the person, so the person can then either access the medications that they need or take themselves off to a place of safety. We're talking about conditions like type 1 diabetes, like POTS disease, which is a sort of heart condition or blood pressure condition causing collapse, Addison's disease, which is a hormonal disorder, and various allergies. Before they had their guardians, their knights in shining armor, these people may have been very, very restricted in what they could do, had no confidence, no independence, and may well have been confined to their own homes because of the risk of collapse and injury, or worse. What always strikes me when I see these dogs working is just how much they love their job. Now, I enjoy my work, but hey, being fed a little treat every now and again would certainly help things along a little bit. You may have, as I initially did, rather nightmarish, dystopian views of sterile-looking laboratories with miserable-looking dogs in tiny cages sitting in front of conveyor belts of human samples that they have to sniff at. Well, I can reassure you, nothing could be further from the truth. The charity has a strict no-kennel policy. The dogs all live with volunteer families. It's all just a game for them. They do the job, they get a reward. But for us, this could be a real game changer. And these dogs will save lives. I want to pass on now to Mr. Chris Allen, who has the enviable job of being the dog supply and training manager at Medical Detection Dogs. And he's going to show you some of these brilliant beasts in action.
Thank you very much, Dr. Christian. That's it. Give him a round of applause. Okay, so before any of our dogs become a medical alert assistance dog or become a bite detection dog, there's a lot of work that's got to happen. And the hard work starts with our wonderful volunteers. Without our volunteers, our charity would not exist. Please give Shirley coming into the arena with her 20-month-old little working Cocker Spaniel. He's met his client. So in a few months' time, he's going to be out working as a life-saving assistance dog, saving someone who has type 1 diabetes. Next, we've got coming into the arena a lovely 8-month-old yellow Labrador called Chip. Give Chip a round of applause. Chip is socialised close to our headquarters around in Buckinghamshire. Next, we've got Misty, also an 8-month-old Labrador, being socialised in our Essex area. These are brothers and sisters, believe it or not. They've come from the same litter. Look at the size difference. That's it. Give them a warm welcome. Our socialisers are supported by the team back at the centre with all our trainers. So we've got Sammy coming into the arena now with a lovely chocolate Labrador, 9-month-old chocolate Labrador called Basil. And then lastly into the ring, we've got Steve coming in with his 18-month-old Labradoodle. So as well as these puppies, we've got about another 50 puppies in socialising at our centre. And they come from all different walks of life. They come from breeders, they come from private homes, and we've got a couple of dogs, Louie and Jasper, that have come to us from Dogs Trust and Wood Green. So we take dogs from rescue centres as well. So as they leave the arena, give them a round of applause. They're going to be life-saving assistance dogs or biodetection dogs supporting the development of medical science. I'm now going to pass you over to a very, very special lady. It's Claire, Dr. Claire Guest, who's the founder of Medical Detection Dogs and the chief executive. So give Claire a round of applause as she comes into the ring.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you. So, well, it was 20 years ago when the first anecdotes started to be heard that dogs seem to be able to detect cancer in their owners. You've probably heard of them. I was privileged to be part of the first study published in the British Medical Journal that indicated that dogs can indeed be trained to find human cancer. And what a difference that's going to make. But Medical Detection Dogs was founded in 2008 to take this work further and to see the potential for saving lives. Let me introduce you to the science of the smell of disease. It's exciting, isn't it? Now, we all know that these dogs... Our dogs may have fluffy coats, very waggy tails, and sometimes very muddy paws, but they have got the most sophisticated sensors, much more sophisticated than any technology on the planet. We know a dog can track unique odours. They can track our odour for many miles. What we now know is that they can detect the odour of disease, and each disease has its own unique odour. If you look to my right here, we're going to look at the carousel. Kizzy, the little working cocker, is going to work round. There are urine samples, and tiny urine samples in each pot. If she smells the odour of cancer, she will sit and indicate that she's found it. And there she goes. Please give her a round of applause. Now, that looks easy, but we mustn't forget that this is quite remarkable. Kizzy has just found, from a drop of urine, somebody who's sadly suffering from prostate cancer. Now, if we go to my left, on the stands here, in each stand, there's a swab, a head swab that's been taken across the forehead. One of these individuals has Parkinson's disease. If he finds it, Bumper will stop at the stand. Again, totally remarkable. These dogs are absolutely wonderful at their jobs. Parkinson's disease has no current early diagnostic test. So you've seen it with your own eyes, and I'm sure you believe it, but there's still a lot of scepticism about this work. For me, the story became personal when my beautiful dog, Daisy, warned me of an undiagnosed breast cancer. Sadly, Daisy passed away 2 years ago, hence my Daisy scarf today. Without her, I could well not be here today to tell you this story. Whether it's the dogs that do this work, or whether it's technology that learns from our fantastic dogs, this is going to save lives around the world. And just to finish, I want to thank you. I want to show you some world firsts. So please, if our world first can come in. So this is a world first dog. Now, this is a canine cancer detection dog being supported by the Kennel Club Foundation. Please give her a round of applause. She is going to detect bladder cancer in her canine companions. Secondly, we have a malaria detection dog. Now, parasites are very clever things. They change our odour. This dog can detect whether somebody is carrying the malaria parasite. This could change diagnosis in the future. And thirdly, what could be more poignant this week than a bacteria detector dog? This dog detects Pseudomonas, but we have dogs working in other bacterias and we'll have them in viruses. We know that this could be a major, or is a major threat to mankind in the future. So please give a, I'm going to hand back over to Chris, but give these wonderful, wonderful dogs a round of applause.
Okay, thank you ever so much, Dr. Claire Guest, for that wonderful insight to how our bi-direction dogs are trained. So, while these guys leave the arena, we're all now going to bring in our medical alert assistance dog. So we've got Becky, Presley, the Black Labrador, and Helen over here. And then we've got Deborah and Nell over here. Nell's a dog in advanced training. So we're going to show you some of the scenarios that our dogs would be expected to work to and how we train them when working with clients. So you've got Presley over here. He's picked up the odour change in Becky, and I don't know whether you saw that, but he alerted her. He gave her a paw, he got her attention, which was enough to then get Becky's attention, and she would then take treatment. Over here, we've got Nell working, so Nell's learning the first stages in the odour. So it's come in close, come in tight, get excited, show interest around me, because you're going to get a treat if you really, really respond to me. So you can see here, she's busy sniffing, that's it, using that nose. There we are, she'll get a treat. Over here, we've got Becky now getting into bed. So, have a sniff, he's going to get close, and then he'll soon, hopefully, pick up the smell that Becky, the odour change in Becky, and he's going to get on the bed, he's tracing it. He's having a good sniff. Lots of dogs have been in this arena. There we go, got the alert. He's now going to go and retrieve the testing kit and bring it back to Becky. So she would then be able to test her blood and also take her medication. So these are clients that have got type 1 diabetes, potentially a cardiac condition called POTS, could be allergies, it could be Addison's. So clients with real life-threatening conditions. We've seen some of our scenarios, but what I want you to do now is look at the screen, and we've got some real-time, nighttime footage from one of our assistance dogs out working. So we've got Jeff asleep in the bed here. Charlie's come into scene there. He's detected that there's a cortisol change in his client. So he's jumped on the bed to wake him up. If he didn't wake him up, Jeff could end up in hospital. It's that clear. So he's come across, he's woken him up, and he's now reached across for his medication. So this is really important for all our clients. As you can see, it is real life-changing stuff that our dogs do. I'm now going to pass you back over to Dr. Christian, who's been joined by some wonderful, wonderful life-saving partnerships.
Thank you, Chris. Right, now I want you guys to meet and actually hear some of the people who are lucky enough to live with these wonderful beasts. So first up here is Lizzie with her dog, Henry. Please give her a big round of applause. And Lizzie, I want to ask you really how having Henry has changed your future outlook. How has he changed life for you?
Yeah, so I have a condition called POTS, which stands for postural tachycardia syndrome. And it basically means when I'm upright, my heart rate rapidly increases and my blood pressure drops, causing me to black out frequently. Before I had Henry, the lack of alerts meant that I was constantly hurting myself and I had to be babysat, and I just had in a childlike state, basically. But then my hero dog came along, and he gives me about a 5-minute warning before a blackout happens, and I can get to a safe place, lay down, let the episode happen, no injury, no chaos. And it's just been wonderful. He's opened up so many doors. I graduated uni last year, and I'm looking at a master's degree now. He's just saved my life.
Amazing. It's wonderful to hear that. Thank you. Thank you. And over here, we have Jamie and his mum, Naomi, and Richmond. That's Richmond, isn't it? Jamie, you've had type 1 diabetes really for as long as I think you can probably remember. And I know it's really severely affected you and your family. Can you tell us a little bit what life was like before you got Richmond?
Until I had Richmond, I used to always have an adult in my bedroom, often a nurse, and always spent Christmases and birthdays in hospital.
And now, how are things? Let's ask your mum. Give her a go.
So life was very much testing Jamie every sort of 15 minutes to 2 hours at the absolute most, 24 hours a day. And life revolved around the test, the results of the test, treating the test, and then waiting for the next test. So with Richmond, life is great.
I feel like you have a bit more freedom now, I hope. Guys, thank you very, very much. Well, there's no better way, is there, than actually seeing these dogs do their stuff in front of you. It is quite extraordinary to watch. within just seconds, they can accurately identify relevant samples. And if you think about what we currently do with testing, tests can take much, much longer to get results. Tests can be a lot more invasive. They can be uncomfortable, causing a lot of distress and a lot of worry for families whilst they wait. So think about how these dogs can really change things medically for us. You saw Presley and Neil show how they can, it doesn't matter what their partners are doing, they will quickly know when danger is imminent and they will make the appropriate warning sign. Can you imagine having such a reliable bodyguard with you 24/7? Now, this is in many ways the most important bit. This charity receives no government funding whatsoever. It relies entirely on charitable donations. And if you're as impressed by what you've seen today as I certainly am, then please, please do consider getting involved. You can fundraise, you can volunteer, or you can consider sponsoring a puppy like little Dottie up there for only £5 a month. Please consider making a difference by helping them, because you know that they will be tirelessly helping us. Thank you very much.